Mark Cocanougher.
The first time I saw my Aunt Carol perform, and in fact my first live theater experience, was when she played the title role in Auntie Mame. I was 4 years old. And I can recall sitting on my knees in the seat so that I could see above the adult heads in front of me. I also remember being enthralled and very proud of my aunt, and a little confused and maybe unhappy because she kept referring to another little boy as her nephew. In the years since then, since that evening and really right up until her death, she would refer to that play and to those roles as a kind of template for our relationship. And then I would say something smart-ass like, well, it's a good thing you ended up in musical comedy and not your first intention, which was Greek drama. Because if I had attended a performance of Medea, things might have turned out very differently for us. But of course, real life is more complex and nuanced than depicted by characters in a play. We were always very close, had a very strong bond, but particularly in the last couple of years, as age and illness created more acute challenges, she extended to me a level of trust and intimacy that I came to regard as almost sacred. I had the awareness, after all, that I was helping to escort her through the end of her life. Some facts about her life. She was born Mildred Frances Cook in the West Texas town of Abilene on January the 14th, 1924. She was the first of four children, my mother Regina being the youngest. Speaking of family, also here today is somewhere Carol's beloved stepson Christopher Troop and his wife Becky. Also Carol's niece Debbie Zolke and her husband Dennis, who drove here from Lubbock, and as we say in Texas, bless your hearts. Carol and Tom's godson, Tim England, his wife Julie, and their family are here as well. Many friends, many friends, obviously. Carol, there was nothing in our family, in Carol's family, that would have lent itself to the idea that acting would be a viable profession. She didn't come from a theatrical family. She wasn't fulfilling any sort of legacy, but she just had that need, that sort of sense of purpose to perform, to be an actress. It was something she said she always wanted. And there were certainly people along the way that helped nurture that ambition. Paul Baker was the theater director, the head of the theater department at Baylor University, where Carol got her degree, in 1945. And in fact, she was working on her master's degree in Greek drama when he essentially said, enough, enough. If you're gonna be an actress, go act. And at that time, that meant New York. So Carol left, little Mildred Frances from Abilene, Texas, went off to New York, and I know she's talked about how scary that was, but exciting as well. And she certainly did work in New York. She did a nightclub act, she did some summer stock, a lot of summer stock, she did some industrial shows, I think, two modes of entertainment that are essentially extinct now, I think. Eventually she went to California. She became Carole Cook. She met my Uncle Tom Troop, and they were married on March the 7th, 1964, which would make tomorrow their 59th wedding anniversary. Although last night, Tom said to me, Mark, We lived together for a year before we married, so really it's 60 years. And so, thank you for sharing that with me. And Carol had a wonderful long life. She had the life she really kind of wanted. She had a career that she loved. I certainly won't go through her resume, her list of credits. You certainly know a lot of them. But acting was really her, it was the fuel. Entertaining, performing was the fuel that powered her engine. That was always a big thing for her. And unlike a lot of people her age who retain more memories than possibilities, Carol was always looking to the next thing. She was always looking forward to the next performance, the next event, the next group of people to meet, the next adventure. Anyone who has endured a long hospital stay is aware of the monotony, the tedium. You're in an unfamiliar setting. You lose track of time. You suffer loss of sleep, and in that condition, there can be a kind of a void that other thoughts and ideas can fill. And particularly if you're elderly and you have infections or inflammations, and it's called a hospital delirium. And Carol was not immune to that. Occasionally, when she was in the hospital, in the middle of the night especially, I would get a phone call. And one time she called me in the middle of the night. I picked up and she said, "Mark, I'm very upset." And I said, "What's going on?" And she said, "Well, there's a young man here with a clipboard, and he keeps calling my name. And I know what it's about. He wants me on the set." And I said, "Oh." And she said, "I don't have the script, and I don't even know who the AD is." And I said, "Well, Carol, I said, it's okay. I've talked to the head of production, and she's a very nice woman, and she thinks you're terrific. And they're going to shoot around you for now, but the main thing is that you rest. And she understands that you need to rest, and they're going to wait for you. And there's nothing for you to worry about. And if the man with the clipboard comes back around again, just have them call me. You've got my number. Just have them call me." And she said, "Okay." She said, "Well, that's better. I think I'm going to go to sleep now." And I said, "That's great." And she said, "Can I tell them that you're my manager?" And I said, "Absolutely. Tell them that I'm your manager." And I hung up the phone and I thought, well, at least she's working. You know, in my hometown of Decatur, Texas, which is a very small community, when a loved one dies, we call the funeral home and put a notice in the local paper. This is a little different from that. But I've come to understand over my time here in Los Angeles, and particularly in the process of putting this event together, that this is a small community as well. Not only in the sense that we are all tangibly connected to Carol, but because I think so many of you are people who conceive and perform and direct and write and compose works of artistic merit and I believe social value, and particularly when it can be performed in the service of a worthy cause. And I believe that is why you are here to celebrate Carol, along with her vibrant presence and generous spirit and quick wit. Those are not small achievements. I believe that is important work. What could be more useful or urgent than the ability to get on a stage and tell hundreds, make hundreds of or even thousands of people laugh, or to enchant them with a song, or to recite words that mirror back our individual and collective humanity. I would like to thank you all for being here. This is really gratifying and it's amazing. And I would like to thank all of the people on the stage, all these bright and talented people for being here, and all of the volunteers who have lent their time and their taste and their talent to cajole and charm and organize and appease to make this event happen. This is really special. There have been so many times in these last weeks when I've thought to myself, I wish Carol could see this. She would love it. And I want to tell you today, I wish Carol could see this. She would love it. And she would love you for being here. Thank you so much.
I will never forget driving in front of your house in Roxbury. Your mother was standing in the doorway. She had on slacks that were sort of the King and I blue color, a pink fuzzy sweater on with the orange hair. And it was exactly like when I was a kid, when I'd see movie magazines, when it would say, "A Visit with Lucie Ball," standing at the door. My dear, I thought I'd died and gone to heaven. She was standing in the door and said, "Mildred Francis, welcome to Hollywood." Well, I could not get over it. We went inside. Willie Mae came in. I remember Willie Mae so well. She came in and said, Lucie said, "You'll take Miss Cook's bags to the guest house." Now, my bags consisted of two cardboard boxes wrapped with string. And I remember Willie Mae said, "If Miss Cook will give me the keys," I said, "There are no keys, but there's a butcher knife. You can just cut the string." Well, Lucie just loved that. I had no act whatsoever, but she asked me about my family. She asked me about, I told her about my grandmother from hell. I told her about my childhood and growing up. And your mother always had sort of a fantasy thing about families and grandmothers and all of that. The dream. And that's what she liked. I was a very lucky girl. When I first came to California, your mother wanted me to live there at the house, which I was certainly thrilled to do. I mean, the next door neighbor, I couldn't get over it. Is Jack Benny. And one night we were sitting at the dining table, I swear to you, and there were only like, I guess you really, were you there? I think you were there. That's it. You and Desi. And I think it was just the family, just us. And the back door, we heard the back door open. We're sitting there eating. Jack Benny comes in playing the violin, goes around the table, does not say one word, doesn't say, "Is this funny?" Forget it. Nothing. He played the violin, walked all the way through the kitchen, walked. We heard him go all the way home. Da 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 da. Never said one word. I thought, this is really a miracle here I'm living. I mean, who would have thought that Mildred Francis Cook from Abilene, Texas, would be sitting here with Lucille Ball and Jack Benny? But it was wonderful.
Ladies and gentlemen, Lucie Arnaz.
Yeah, so I've known Carol since I was 9. And she literally, as she said, lived in our house. And I didn't have a lot of grown-ups at that time to compare her to. My folks, maybe my grandmother Dee Dee. But I knew she was fun. She was big and brassy, and she never treated me like a little kid. She never talked to me like a child. And oh God, how she made us laugh. And you know, she talks about being Mildred Francis Cook. Well, it was my mother who actually changed her name to Carol Cook. She said after she met her, Carol told me that my mother said to her, "You have the same healthy disrespect for everything in general as my friend Carol Lombard, and I want you to change your name to Carol and spell it with an E." So she did, boom, like that. I think I heard that she said, "Thank God that she didn't say Rin Tin Tin, because I said yes so fast." Rin Tin Tin. You're right, that is funny. I still remember her, Carol Cook, blowing the roof off of the Desilu Studio Little Theater, belting out, "I'm your red hot mama," in Mom's, as she was Mom's big new discovery in the Desilu Review at the time, along with the extraordinarily gifted Marilyn Lovell, who ended up having a brilliant career and marrying the musical genius of Peter Matz. And I guess that Mom had a very, she had a pretty good eye for real talent, because years later it was Carol Cook and Marilyn Lovell that would take turns stopping every LA stage benefit show here that they were in, remember? Yeah, I know a lot of you out there were there. So by about 11, I was testing my acting chops with tiny little parts on my mother's second sitcom, which was called The Lucie Show, where Carol had been consistently working as Thelma, which was a character that she actually created for herself. And then later on, when I was a regular on Mom's next series called Here's Lucie, Carol and I finally got to work together as a team. Because back in those days, on the Here's Lucie Show, we used to do dozens of big musical production numbers. And every time that my mother and I had a musical number that we had to learn, rehearse, pre-record, she would hire Carol Cook to sing her part for her. The secret is out. And every time that Carol was on set, as we say, there was always a heightened atmosphere. I mean, her Texas drawl and whip-fast percussive retorts are now legend, of course. But at 15, I'm sure I was a precocious little oddity when I started trying to mimic them, saying, "Oh, I'm as pure as the driven slush. Oh, honey, we're just circling the drain." Or from the picture, "Who cares?" And of course, her trademark, "Make a face for Jesus," which I would have paid big bucks to see when it finally happened. I don't know that I've ever known anyone as loyal or as loving or as sassy or as grounded as Carol Cook. And after so many years of never getting anything but that indomitable spirit, you know, whenever you were with her, I realized why I think she was able to stay that way. Because some 60 plus years ago, she was given a very special gift that allowed her to shine and was a hefty reminder of what was really important in life. And she never, ever took that gift for granted. And that gift was Tom Troop. You gave her life purpose, Tom, and she loved you with every fiber of her being. And your resilient union was one of the greatest inspirations to my husband, Larry, and I. Our goal always was to find a way to maintain a marriage, a relationship that was as real and as loving as yours was. To, I don't even know what the right word, mesh together and support one another as you both did. I know you know how much she idolized you. And I know how hard it must have been for her to leave you, to finish your duet alone without the accompaniment of her wit and her sensibility. But she could never have sustained the way she did to a full and captivating 99 years without you maintaining her rhythm. And I just want to thank you, Tom Troop, for giving her the best years of her life. You know? I would love nothing more right now than to be able to flip back to that dinner table in our home, Roxbury Drive in Beverly Hills, that summer night when Carol and I were privy to that very odd and exclusive Jack Benny violin serenade. Talk about indelible memories. But in that clip from the interview that I did with Carol, she left some stuff out. My memory of that evening is that, yes, just like she said, we were all sitting around the dinner table and the back door opened and suddenly there was a guy walking in playing violin music and he turned down around the corner, you go, it's Jack Benny. And he never smiled, just like she said, he just played and he walked around the dinner table and my mother was screaming with laughter. Everybody was laughing. He walked all the way around, he got to my stepfather, Gary Morton, and Gary pulled out a $20 bill. And Jack took it. And then he kept right on going, just as Carol said, all the way down the hall. And of course, my mother was just like, oh my God, and she threw her napkin up and she ran out and she hugged him and she saw him out the door and they walked through the carport and he just jumped over the hedge because he lived right next door, right? And he's carrying his violin and she's going, I can't believe you did that. I love you so much. And it's summertime and he gets to his front door and he goes like this and he's locked out. Mary locked the door on him after he left. So he looks at her and he goes, can you believe Mary locked me out? Well, it's summertime, as I said, and there are these tour buses that go through Beverly Hills about every 15 minutes. And all of a sudden, you hear down the street,
ladies and gentlemen, Mr. Ira Gershwin's house on the right, Mr. Ira Gershwin, and on the right, on the left, ladies and gentlemen, the Jack, and ladies and gentlemen, Jack Benny is in front of his house right now. That is Jack Benny.
And he looks at the tour bus, and he looks at my mother, and he just goes, da 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 da.
Quiet!
Call me Naomi. Control yourself, Henry. We have a guest.
Either those fish go or I do.
It was a joy to be here. I was at Warner Brothers. I was doing movies. I loved, absolutely loved doing them. The Incredible Mr. Limpet was my first movie.
If you paid half as much attention to me as you do those fish, I'd be the happiest wife in Flatbush.
Never having done a movie, they said, hit your mark. And I went, who's Mark? Jack Weston saved my life. He went, Carol, it's on the floor. It's the mark there.
The only thing I ever put in my orange juice is gin.
The movies are America and are fabulous, and you can still learn from them. You see great scenes, great work. I can't wait to see what's going to happen.
That's better.
Ladies and gentlemen, Mr. Jason Graae, and at the piano, Mr. Michael Orland.
Hi, everybody. I actually didn't know Carole Cook, but I saw the guest list, and so I thought this would just make a really good career move. So that's kind of weird, but I was a big fan. I loved her so. I loved Tom so. All right, so about 9 years ago, I got married to my husband. It was convenient. Thank you. Glenn Fretwell of Glenn Fretwell Landscape Design. 310-994-0338. And so we got married in our backyard, and we asked Carol and Tom to give the big toast before we cut the cake. And so we all raised our glasses, and Carol and Tom raised their glasses, and Carol said, we have an announcement to make. We are your real parents. We put you up for adoption when you were babies, and you went to two different families, your brothers. We needed to tell you this before your honeymoon night. Oh my God, I'm so relieved that we waited 15 years to consummate our relationship, so. Whew. So perfectly inappropriate. And so, Carol. And Tom. Anyway, I would like to sing one of their most favorite songs. You reappearing in my mind. You were right and I was blind. But that was long ago. Now, do I ever cross your mind? Are your memories like mine? Or have they let you go? After all the loves I've lived through all these years, I had to go so far without you. Now it's clear. You were my favorite love. That was my favorite year. Back there, would we stay? After all the loves I've lived through all these years, I had to go so far without you. Now it's clear, you were my favorite love. That was my favorite year. You were my favorite love. That was my favorite year.
I can't remember much about my life before Carol, but the moment we met, I knew that something extremely special was happening to me. There was joy every single hour of every day. My spirit and my confidence soared more than any time in my life. And the love I felt for Carol is the kind of love I used to read about in books, but I never experienced. And the moment I met her, it came to me, and I was able to receive it and to offer it. And I'm forever grateful for that. And 2 weeks ago yesterday, we celebrated our 45th wedding anniversary.
I was 12 when we met. And this is how it all began. I went to see a production of Harold Pinter's The Caretaker, and I saw this brilliant actor. His name was Tom True. And so now, 45 years later, we're approaching the menopause of that marriage. He still brings me coffee in bed. He doesn't make it. He gets it at Starbucks. It's the thought that counts.
In time, the Rockies may crumble, Gibraltar may stumble. They're only made of clay, but our love is here to
stay. Mr. Michael Feinstein.
The more I read the papers, the less I comprehend. The world and all its capers, and how it all will end. Nothing seems to be lasting, but that isn't our affair. We've got something permanent, I mean in the way we care. In a world full of long runs, Tom and Carol had one of the longest. Tomorrow would have been their 59th anniversary. Their love is forever. It's very clear. Our love is here to stay. Not for a year, but ever and a day. The radio and the telephone and the movies that we know may just be passing fancies, and in time may go. But oh my dear, our love is here to stay. Together we're going a long, long way. In time the Rockies may crumble, Gibraltar may tumble. They're only made of clay, but our love is here to stay.
to stay.
One of her nearest and dearest, Betsy Hailey.
Hello, it's so good to be here with all of you, FOCs, Friends of Carol. I was going to say the word in the spirit of Carol, but my daughters discouraged me. Oliver, I'm speaking today on behalf of my whole family. My late husband, Oliver Hailey, the playwright, our daughters, Kendall and Brooke, and their husbands and children. Oliver and I first met Carol and Tom over 50 years ago at a small dinner party where we were soon under the spell of Carol and her uncensored wit. She was having as her target the current television season, and she took particular aim at a show drama series, new drama series set in Hollywood. Anybody remember Bracken's World? No. Anyway, Carol, everyone was laughing at Carol's take on it when Oliver suddenly confessed, "I wrote that episode." Carol was doing the most excruciating about face when he said, "Don't worry, Carol, I didn't like it any more than you did." We fell in love with Tom and Carol that night, and I soon learned never to plan a party without first checking their availability. Carol's acceptance usually came with a request, Dupar's brownies for dessert. We shared our last Dupar's brownies with Carol and her family just this past Christmas Eve. At the time we met, Oliver was working on a new play about three divorced women on Father's Day. With each new draft, the leading character of Louise sounded more and more like Carol. And indeed, when she did play the part, she was absolutely magnificent, opposite an equally magnificent Barbara Rush. And from that collaboration came a beautiful friendship. Carol continued to bring down the house at our house with her hilarious stories about growing up in Texas, which was a heritage Oliver and I shared. And then on to her early days in New York when she took all manner of odd jobs, and I mean weird odd, her favorite being the Marty Bra Brassiere Company. Guess what everyone on her list got for Christmas that year? One night after she had charmed yet another set of guests at our house, Oliver said, "Carol, this stuff is gold, and you are giving it away." He said, "You have the makings of a wonderful one-woman show." "I'm not a writer," she protested. He said, "You don't have to write a word. Just come over to our house one afternoon, start telling your stories. Tom can tape them and transcribe them, and I'll look at the pages and shape it into some kind of rough script. Then you and Tom can take it from there." Well, take it they did. That was the first of the many one-woman shows that Carol performed for the rest of her life. At the beginning of our friendship, I was just the wife, but Carol always treated me like the pro I would later become. And after Oliver died 30 years ago this year, Carol and I became the very best of best friends. We talked over the phone, lengthy conversations, comparing, sharing confidences and concerns. And I always tried to call her when I knew she was back at Cedars once again, where she hated to be and where she spent far too much of her time in her later years. Toward the end, when one of our last phone calls, I could tell she was really near tears. And she said to me, "I've been talking a lot to Blanche," Blanche being her word for God. She said, "Blanche, I don't know how much more of this I can take." I said, "Carole, none of us understands how you have been able to take as much as you have and take it and take it." But I did know. Carole continued to take it and take it through so much pain and suffering because she didn't want to leave Tom. Tom and Carole, a love story that will go on and on. In closing, I'd like to quote the late Queen, and who better to quote in a tribute to Carole? At the height of the COVID crisis, the Queen closed her speech with the comforting words, "We shall meet again, and so we shall, darling Carole. We will forever love you, and we shall meet again."
Ladies and gentlemen, JoAnne Worley.
No, that's me. And did we ever lunch with Carole? We had a group and we called ourselves the Ladies Who Lunch. I know it's not original, but it was on the money. And we would eat and laugh and have a good time and swap stories. And actually, there were some of our Ladies Who Lunch are up on stage and there are some in the audience. And we remember what we would do. We wouldn't solve world problems or famine or anything like that. What we did is we would say, "Oh, I know, next meeting," we called them meetings once a month, "bring in the jewelry you're not wearing and we'll exchange it." "Whose do you think this is?" "Of course. Oh, this one is killing me, Carole. Killing me." We would have lunch and we would laugh, and I knew that I wanted to try and make her laugh when she was in the hospital. Remember, Tom, the day I came by in my nonsense outfit? Black all the way to the floor with the sensible shoes and lots of prayer beads and everything. And I walked in, Tom of course was there, and there was a male nurse in the room. And when he left, I asked Carole, I said, "Do you think I fooled him? Yeah, do you think he thought I was a nun?" And she thought for a minute, she said, "Well, I think the Gucci bag is suspicious. And the false eyelashes was really the big tip off." But we would laugh and enjoy each other and have a good time. And I would always bring my little doggy, Cupid, my little rescued doggy, in his own bag to lunch. And Carole found out that he loved bacon. I mean, really loved bacon. And so she would order her lunch with a side order of bacon for Cupid every time. So Cupid would always refer to her as Our Lady of the Bacon. And I think, ladies and gentlemen, we should hear from some of the other Ladies Who Lunch.
One of the other Ladies Who Lunch, Jane A. Johnston.
There he is.
Oh, my dears, you've never seen anything unless you go into Craig's with Carole. And hear the waiter singing, "Hello, Carole. Well, hello, Carole." She's a wonder, one of a kind, a phenomenon. I met that phenomena 64 years ago. Now, I know you don't remember, or any of you could possibly think I remember, but I do. I was in Pittsburgh, and she was playing La Lume in Kismet. I was the next show coming up. So I saw the production of Kismet and went backstage afterwards and introduced myself. And then she talked, and I couldn't understand anything she was saying. It was very fast, very Southern. But she did, finally, I figured one thing. She said something about a woman was so skinny that she could slip into the room through under the door. I mean, I didn't get it. Do you? Oh, she wasn't Carol then, too. She was Mildred. I had been hearing people talking about her in Greenwich Village, saying that she was at the number one Fifth Avenue and she was a go-see. I didn't go see. But in the meantime, all of us, the ladies who lunch, have shared a fellowship. And that fellowship is being theater people. Theater people create a home because they love what they're doing and they love show folk. They really do. We are closer. You can't get that in television. You can't get it in film. You only can get it in the theater. We have disappointments and we have celebrations, but we do it together. And that's what we've been, all of us. I mean, Nancy and I had, gosh, one of our most important Broadway appearances together at the City Center. I think it was the first for both of us. We're friends. We can count on each other. Notice the necklace? It's from one of those trades that we had. Nights, how long since you went away? I think about you all through the day, my buddy, nobody quite so true. Miss your smile, the touch of your hand, I long to think that you understand. My buddy, your buddy misses you.
Ladies and gentlemen, Nancy Dussault.
Hi, everybody. Yes, this is wonderful to be a part of this. And yes, JoAnne. JoAnne, for these luncheons of these splendid women, all with interesting careers, personalities, JoAnne made all the arrangements and made sure we got together. I even drove in from Oxnard. So that, but Carol was our queen. And we were delighted to have a queen. I never had a queen in my life before. So she was the treat. And we all waited for her to arrive, and darling Tom would escort her in, always in her simple black dress, bedecked with jewels, looking like $1 million with that red hair and those big brown eyes. She was a joy to be with. She really filled us up. We all had a very special, special feeling. And I think what I really loved the most about her was her life was so big and so full, and she had a passionate devotion to her family, to her work, and to Tom most of all. I mean, I'm thrilled that I was part of her world. I find it a real blessing. This song is kind of a treat and a toast to the group, to Carol. Here's to you, here's to me, here's to our lives to be, and for what we foresee, here's to love, here's to all that was said, as we look straight ahead, here's to where liking led, here's to love. And if Carol were here, I think this is probably what she would sing to us. Here's to us, my darling, my dears. Here's to us tonight. Not for what may happen next year, for it may not be nearly as bright. For better or worse, and thanks to a merciful star, here's to us, we'll keep muddling through, just for me and for you, as we are.
I'd like to propose a toast. Raise your imaginary glass in your real right arm. A toast to Carol.
Dolly will never go away again.
Carol with an E.
Been standing here doing obscene gestures the entire evening.
I've told you 100 times, there's not a deaf person in that audience. Nobody knows what the hell you're saying. You've had work done, haven't you?
Mary had a little lamb.
Mr. John Maher.
Well, I hope you can tell we had a lot of fun. It was a lot of years. It was basically an innocent 3-minute bit that we stretched out for over 30 years. So, ta-da. And you may have noticed that for some of you who've been to these stage benefits, I never spoke with Carol. And that was because anytime someone made a suggestion, go, well, maybe John should say that, or maybe John can sing that, Carol, no. Turn to me, and she'd say, you can speak when I'm dead. So if you think I was going to pass up this opportunity to speak about Carole Cook, think again. I have a couple things to say. It's all good. Carol and I have known each other, knew each other a long time, but we got to know each other doing the stage benefits. This was way back in the early 80s. And it was an annual benefit, for those of you who didn't know, filled with lots and lots of talent. And it was a fundraiser for HIV and AIDS research and those people who are already diagnosed or dealing with it at the time. And Carol was a very prominent part of that. And it ran for over 3 decades, and it raised millions of dollars. And one of the things I loved about it was our process. Sorry. Our process was not normal. it kind of went like this. So I would meet Carol and David Galligan, the director, at his house, usually. And we most of the time, we had the last rehearsal spot for rehearsing. And so we would get there. Tom would drop Carol off, and he'd go off, and the three of us would sit and kind of pitch ideas and kind of go back and forth in kibitz and pitch jokes. And after about an hour, Tom would come back to pick up Carol, and then we'd have a cocktail. And then we'd keep talking and keep pitching and keep kibitzing. And eventually we'd kind of have a concept of what to do. And then we'd go off, and then Carol and I would continue to work on it all the way up to the show. And David, we'd all just kind of keep going. But Carol worked on it literally up to the time where she came on stage. And so even at intermission, I would run back after the first act, and I'd go into her dressing room, and we'd sit down, and I'd tell her what happened during the first act, to see what she missed, or like who had a wardrobe malfunction, or, and then she'd be taking notes. Okay, I got it. So and then I'd go back out, and then she would keep working, and she'd come out, and then we'd kind of wing it. So there was always that element of it, and even in the second clip, there's a joke she used to do all the time, which is. Pay him $1 million a year, and there's not a single deaf person in the house. And I was like, oh, it's a good, I've usually got a good laugh, and so we'd do that for years, it was fine, and then I was like, And then one year I was, before the show started, I was down in my little spot, downstage left, and I look out in the audience, and I see a group of about 15 deaf people. So I go, hey, guys, do you want to play a joke on Carole Cook? To which they immediately went, yeah. So sure enough, so I first act ends, I go back at intermission, I fill Carol in on what happened in the first act, and I go, and it's like, I don't know, I don't see any deaf people. So she says, oh, good. So sure enough, she comes back out, she comes out, and some point during the number, she comes over, grabs my arm, she goes, we pay this John $1 million a year, and I bet there's not a single deaf person, to which 15 deaf people immediately stood up and went, Carol, F you! So I watched Carol in 10 seconds go 13 shades of red from every emotion you can possibly see. It was like watching a Fellini film in 10 seconds. And she ended up on just pure laughter and joy, and that's what we did. We just loved to play, and that's what we did. And she never forgot why we were doing the event. And we always talked about it every year, and it was so important to her because it was just so important to her for so long. And so one of the things that she would do, or I would do at almost every year, was using sign language. She would either sign I love you to basically the audience for coming, to the people who had passed from HIV and AIDS, or people who had done the show for so many years who had passed on, and just to remember them and say, hey, we remember you, we know you, and we're not forgetting you. And so one of the things I would do is I would take the I love you sign and I would kind of crush it up into kind of what I called love dust. And because I did it, Carol would call it love fairy dust, but I digress. So what we'd do is kind of spread it out and then send it out into the universe, into the audience, and up to the ethos to say, hey, we remember you. So today, I guess I get to do it for Carol. So thank you, Carol. We love you. And I got to speak. Ha ha. Here we go.
Hear the beat of his dancing feet, Mr. Leroy Reams.
Dip! I know I had that one on at least once. In case you're wondering why Carol and I were bosom buddies, we wore the same size shoes. She left me these. I was hoping for Lucille Ball's pearls, but that's show business. When we were in 42nd Street together, Carol used to come to my dressing room door, throw it open. She said, "Here's my latest pair of high heels. Break these suckers in." And indeed, I did break them in. I wore them around the theater. I didn't know Carol until we did 42nd Street together. First day of rehearsal, she walked up to me and she said, "So, you must be Leroy Reams." And I said, "Yes, and you must be Carole Cook." She said, "Every sister boyfriend I have says to me, 'I want to meet Leroy, you're just gonna love him.' I love you." I already hate your fucking guts. We went to lunch that day, and from then on, we were joined for eternity, let me tell you. Now, on that first day of rehearsal in the afternoon after lunch, Gower was going to set the gypsy tea kettle scene in which Carol was there with the girls and the character of Peggy Sawyer. And Carol was going to do it without a script because Michael Stewart, who wrote the book, loved Carol, and the part of Maggie Jones was written for Carol. So she was going to do the rehearsal without a script. So they came dancing in and they sat down, and Carol's line was, "Well, Peggy, how'd you like your first day on Broadway?" And she said, "Well, Peggy, how'd you like a finger up your ass? What is that line?" And I did just what you did. And Gower Champion threw me a dirty look. And then he looked at Carol and he said, "Don't ever do that again in my rehearsals." And Carol said, "I apologize, Gower, it will never happen again." She finished the scene, she came over, sat down beside me, and she said, "You know he dances, but he was never known for a sense of humor." One day, and we were both in trouble. Merv Griffin loved Carol. And on one of his shows, he had her on his TV show all the time. And she came and made her entrance and wore one of those wonderful dresses. And Merv said, "Carol, I've been wanting to ask you about these dresses that you wear." And she said, "Be careful, Merv, you're on very thin ice." He said, "Well, I just want to know, what do you call those things you wear? Drapery dresses?" He said, "What's going on underneath all of that?" And she said, "An old friend doing me a favor." Of course, they had to stop tape. And for 10 minutes, Merv didn't get off the floor. One of the conversations I had with Carol, we were talking about the hereafter. And Carol said, "Well, what are you going to do?" I said, "Well, Carol, I'm going to be cremated, and my husband Bob and I are going to have our ashes put together with all the dogs, our little dachshund dogs, and half of them are going to go to Kentucky with my family, and half of them are going to go to Pennsylvania with his family." And I said, "So what are you going to do?" And she said, "I think I'll be stuffed to be next to Trigger." During 42nd Street, I came to California to do the California Company. Seriously, primarily, I wanted to be with Carol. I would go to the theater every night, early. Carol always had the coffee pot on. I went into her room, and by the time the show started, we were laughing hysterically. We went out every night afterward, and we'd go to dinner after the show. I treasured that so much. During one of those performances, the sets, which were automated, came through and a scene change, crashed on stage, and the show had to stop. And the stage manager panicked, and I said, "Don't worry, I'll handle this." So I walked out on stage and I said, "Excuse me, ladies and gentlemen, obviously we have had a problem with the sets tonight, and while the stagehands are fixing it, I would like to tell you how I got my audition for 42nd Street and how I got the part." And I sang this song looking at in the balcony, picturing the dear sweet face of Ruby Keeler. And I knew one of these days this song was going to be on the show. Ironically enough, it was later with Dolores Gray in the First National Company. However, I said, "So I would like to sing this song for you tonight." And I looked into the orchestra pit at Dan Glosser, who was the rehearsal pianist and played the show. And I said, "So, maestro, I only have eyes for you in the key of C." And he went, "I don't know." So I looked at the conductor and I said, "Maestro, I only have eyes for you in the key of C. Anyone in the orchestra? No, I only have eyes for you." So I said, "Don't worry, I'll just do it a cappella." So I started singing, "I only have eyes for you." I got to the last note, and the stage manager came out and said, "Okay, Leroy, the set's fixed." So I creeped off stage, waiting in the wings with Carole Cook. And so she said, "It's been a long time since I've been in these shoes." And I walked off, and Carole was waiting for me in the wings, and she said, "I am so embarrassed for you." "That was the worst thing you have ever done. I don't want anyone to know that I even know you." The next night, during the Lullaby of Broadway number, and if you remember, it was the Broad Street train station in Philadelphia, and the first level was maybe at least a good 12 feet in the air with a horseshoe staircase. And we're down doing the number, and Carole made her entrance, and she got her high heel caught in her dress and fell down the stairs and hit the railing. And I'm telling you, seriously, had she broken the railing, I don't know what would have happened. But she was out, and of course the kids are trying to get down the staircase. They can't because she's passed out, and her wig's askew and her hat's off. And so we just stood there, and the stage manager came out, and they got her up on her feet, and she fixed her wig, and she fixed her hat, and she looked around. The stage manager said, "Carole, are you all right?" She said, "You bet your sweet ass." He said, "Where do you want to take it?" She said, "From my entrance. Everybody out, let's go." She went up, she came down, she finished the number. Now, I was scared to death because her knees were bleeding, and I know she hurt herself. I was waiting for her in the wings, and she came off, and I grabbed her. I said, "My God, Carole, are you all right?" I said, "Look at you." I said, "How did you have the presence of mind to know what to do? And you put on your musical comedy face, and you did the number. How did you manage that?" She said, "I would have done anything to keep you from singing. I only have fucking eyes for you again." And so, my dear friend, I'm singing it tonight for you. My love must be a kind of blind love. I can't see anyone but you. And dear, I wonder if you find love an optical illusion too. Are the stars out tonight? I don't know if it's cloudy or bright, 'cause I only for you, dear. The moon may be high, but There we go. Are we okay? Could...
I don't know.
Take two. Are the stars out tonight? I don't know if it's cloudy or bright, 'cause I only have eyes for you. The moon may be high, but I can't see a thing in the sky, 'cause I only have eyes for you. So am I. Maybe millions of people pass by, but they all disappear from view. I only have eyes for of people pass by, but they all disappear from view. I only have eyes for I love you, Carol.
Mason McCulley.
I want to start by saying to Mark, Carol's nephew, you gave Carol dignity in her final years and even in her final moments. And most importantly, you gave her joy, and we all thank you for that. And I wanna echo what everyone else has already said. Witnessing, Tom, your dedication and your love to Carol is and was an honor. And we all love you and are here for you. June 27th, 2001. Tonight I saw Carole Cook in Hello, Dolly, and I think I could watch her on stage every night. After the show, her husband Tom took us backstage to her dressing room. I have to do theater. It is my passion, dream, and destiny. I hope I get to meet them again in the future. And I did. When I first moved to California, my mother used to always say, I wish that actor couple we met would adopt you. And they did. Carole knew that I was a kid in a candy store in Hollywood, and she loved it. She loved taking me to parties and events and explaining in detail who everyone was. One afternoon, she called me and she goes, tonight, we're going to La Boheme for Jim Bailey's memorial. It's gonna be weird and you're gonna love it. It was, and I did. One time, she took me to a dinner party where the Scotty Bowers was a guest. Uh-huh. She leans over and she goes, you know, he used to stir the cocktails with his cock. Swear to God, she then grabbed my face with her two hands and said, I'm going to open doors for you. Doors you never dreamed existed. And she did. The first time I met Lucie Arnaz, we were backstage in Palm Springs for Carole Channing's 95th birthday. I walked in carrying Carole's dress. Carole said, Lucie, this is Mason. He's an actor from Alabama. And without missing a beat, she said, he's also one of the better fucks in the business. And I think we can all agree that Carole was never wrong. We would go see shows at the Amundsen and afterwards sit at a corner booth at Kitchen 24 drinking martinis and eating cheeseburgers until 2 a.m. It didn't matter if the show was good or bad because we would bring our playbills into the diner and dissect the play, and it was so much fun. I had the privilege of traveling to New York, San Francisco, Palm Springs, and Dallas with Carole and Tom, and there was never not a rose next to Carole's bed. Tom's greatest concern was Carole, and Carole's greatest concern, Tom. They finished each other's sentences, laughed at each other's jokes, and often mixed up each other's stories, but both went with it for the sake of the audience. All of my friends basked in Carole's presence as she told her stories. I loved watching the reactions of friends as the punchline approached. I always effortlessly laughed as if I was hearing it for the first time, and I think we all did, didn't we? We were honest with each other about all things. She certainly didn't hold back when it came to the guys I dated. One night after dining with a very handsome new guy, she grabbed my hand and said, you two don't have the same frame of reference. And that was her way of saying he was dumb. And she was right. We didn't stand on ceremony. I would call Carole after each audition and we would discuss how it went. And I remember a particular not so great audition and called Carole. And she said, listen, I know when I sparkle and I know when I don't, and that's part of it. So after that, my post-audition phone calls would turn into Carole, I didn't sparkle, or Carole, I fucking sparkled. And she got it. She understood my disappointments and my victories with no backstory necessary. My conversations with Carole, whether at dinner or on the phone, were deep and varied, but my favorite moments were after dinner or the theater when I would sit in the living room with Carole and Tom, sipping limoncello, listening to stories about everything, often into the wee hours of the morning. Thank you so much, Carole, for all that you gave me. Every time I spent a minute with you and Tom, it was an adventure, it was exciting, and it was actual magic. Carole always said, the sun never sets on Lucille Ball, because somewhere in the world, at every minute of every hour, there is an episode of I Love Lucy playing. Well, I believe that the curtain never falls on Carole Cook, because somehow, somewhere, I know that right now she's waiting in the wings, preparing for her opening number.
There's no business like show
business, like no business I know. Everything about it is appealing. Everything the traffic will allow. Nowhere could you get that happy feeling when you are stealing that extra bow.
I probably wanted to be a performer. I told you opera was my first love. And that's kind of high flown for a kid. I mean, I'm like 6, 7 years old and I'm listening to opera. But I think, you know, I can't remember ever not wanting to be, I mean, not have said an actress as such, you know. 10 minutes I want to be an opera singer, 10 minutes I want to be in the circus, 10 minutes. I can't remember ever not wanting to be the stage.
Don't give me my hooch because the chooch is gonna leave for Alabama. So kiss your mammy goodnight. Kiss your red heart, mammy. Kiss your red heart, mammy. Kiss your red heart, mammy.
Yourself, Henry. Remember how you always catch cold when you get your feet wet.
Don't break up, Bessie. I'm just fine. Maybe all along I was meant to be a fish. Maybe nature just corrected her error.
Maybe. Well. Goodbye, Henry.
Fred, leave her alone. You'll make her tinkle.
Oh, come on, Helen.
Oh, Sam, let me look at you. Oh. Fred, she's gotten her boobies.
Oh, I'd better go get my magnifying glass.
Oh, and they are so perky.
My, you are making me thirsty just standing there. Now you can open the champagne. Pour me a drink and set the bottle down.
Oh, women are fools. That's old news. But life's too short for you to give in, Irish. So fight. You fight for what's yours. Now that, my friend, is a swagger.
How long did it take him to ask you to marry you?
Well, you know, now he would tell you this is true. I know you'll find this hard to believe, Merv, but he never...
Asked.
He didn't. Yes, he did ask.
You just assumed.
But he thought I would never really marry him. But I fooled him. And
jumped right on.
I said, yeah, right. And he really didn't. He said, I don't think Carol will really ever get married. Well, that was...
How many years ago?
Almost 16 years ago. And isn't that heaven? And they say Hollywood marriages don't last. And for me, my marriage was the most important thing. And... he showed me that he thought so, too. You know what you could do right now, Tom?
What?
Little surprise.
What? What is it?
Here's my wedding ring.
Oh, my gosh.
You want to put it
now
on?
That is a surprise.
I've never seen you without the wedding ring. This is the first time you've taken it off in all those years.
No.
Oh.
You gave me better rings each year.
Okay. Well, then
and
this...
And so this is a keep.
That's funny. That's where I put on the ring. Wow.
Okay.
And I put mine on. Thank you.
You feel safe. And I didn't marry at 18. You know, right after college, everybody got married. And I thought, well, fine, I always wanted to. But I thought, it's got to be like my mother and daddy's. And I knew when I met Tom. I did. I don't know what I... What I do, I admit it. And I'm happy, but
I feel the moon sway.
I admit it's fun to smear my face with paint, causing everyone to think I'm what I ain't. And I love to play a demi-monde role with soul. Does anybody here have any idea what a demi-monde is? Ask the hero, does he like the way I lure when I play a hussy or a paramour? Yet when once the curtain's down, my life is pure. And how I dread it. Life up on the wicked stage ain't ever what a girl supposes. Stage door Johnnies aren't raving over me with gems and roses. If some gentleman would talk with reason, I would cancel all next season. Life up on the wicked stage ain't nothing for a girl. A false alarm, a broken arm, an imitation Hitler, and with littler charm. But oh, can that boy foxtrot? His mouth is mean, he's not too clean. What makes him look reptilian is the brilliantine. But oh, can that boy foxtrot? Quite a bore, but on the floor he ain't. And oh boy, for me, and that boy, for me, and that boy. Sign this. Come out. your bottom dollar that tomorrow he'll be gay. I don't care who knows I am blue. My song wouldn't take long to give my heart away. I know it's plain, my heart's in pain. My song couldn't belong to someone feeling gay. I got a right to sing the blues. I got a right to feel low down. Middle-aged. Blues. Why is my doctor always saying, don't mess with cholesterol? And why the New York Times start to make their print so small? I got those high quick time passes. Need two pair of glasses. Blues. And honey, I just started. Policeman looks so young. My nephews look so old. I agree with editorials. My feet get cold. A little beside us there, a little collide us here. I know you won't believe it, but I dye my hair. On the bus I met a boy toy, muscular and sweet. I smiled at him, he smiled at me, then offered me his seat. I've got those, I should be home taking a There once was a girl named Jenny, whose virtues were varied and many, excepting that she was inclined always to make up her mind. And Jenny points a moral with which you cannot quarrel, as you will find. Mind up when she was three. She herself was going to trim the Christmas tree. Christmas Eve she lit the candles, tossed the tapers away. Little Jenny was an orphan on Christmas Day. Poor Jenny, bright as a penny, her equal would be hard to find. She lost one dad and mother, a sister and a brother, but she would make up her mind. When she was 12, that into foreign languages she would delve. But at 17 to Vassar it was quite a blow, that in 27 languages she couldn't say no. Poor Jenny, bright as a penny, her equal would be hard to find. To Jenny I'm beholden, her heart was big and golden, but she wouldn't make up her mind. Up at 22, to get herself a husband was the thing to do. She got herself all dolled up in her satins and furs. She found herself a husband, but he wasn't hers.
Poor Jenny, bright as a penny, her equal would be hard to find.
Deserved a bed of roses, but history discloses that she would make up her mind. Up at 39, she would take a trip to the Argentine. She was only on vacation, but the Latins agree. Jenny was the one who started the good neighbor policy.
Poor Jenny, bright as a penny, her equal would be hard to find.
Oh, passion doesn't vanish in Portuguese or Spanish, but she would make up her mind. Mind up at 51, she would write her memoirs before she was done. The very day her book was published, history relates, there were wives who shot their husbands in some 33 states.
Poor Jenny, bright as a penny, her equal would be hard to find.
She could give cards and spades to many other ladies, but she would make up her mind. Mind up at 75, she would live to be the oldest woman alive. But Jen and Rom and Destiny play funny tricks, and poor Jenny kicked the bucket at 76.
Jenny points a moral with which you cannot quarrel.
Makes a lot of common sense. Jenny and her saga prove that you are gaga if you don't keep sitting on the fence.
Jenny and her story points the way to glory.
Man and womankind. Anyone with vision comes to this decision. Don't make up, you shouldn't make up, you mustn't make up, oh never make up.
Anyone with vision comes to this decision.
Don't make up your
fortune. Bright as a penny, or equal would be hard to find.
The parade passes by, I'm gonna go and
and taste Saturday's high life before the parade passes by. I'm gonna get some life back into my life. I'm ready to move out in front. I've had enough of just passing by life with the rest of them, with the best of them. I can hold my head up high, for I've got a goal again, I've got a drive again, I've got to feel my heart coming alive again before the parade passes by. Look at that crowd up ahead, listen and hear that brass harmony growing. Look at that crowd up ahead, pardon me if my old spirit is showing. All of those lights over there telling me where I'm going when the whistles blow.